When I was in college, I would come home to visit my folks, and my dad, he would get up early, and he would make coffee, toast, scrambled eggs, bacon, sausage, and now I'm making you all hungry, right? Yeah. And it took me a while to realize that though my dad was not very vocal in terms of expressing his affection, that this was his way of telling me that he loved me, providing for me. And over the years, I've seen too, you know, steadfastness, going to work, making sure that my sister, brother, and I had what we needed in order to grow and to be safe. And it goes to show, brothers and sisters, that love is put into action in one form or another. Otherwise, it's just words. By show of hands, how many of you have ever been in a relationship with somebody who will say how much they love you, but then they do nothing for you, or even worse, they keep mistreating you? And we know that's not love. We see in the gospel and in the first reading, Jesus' admonition, the admonition of God, of the two greatest commandments, to love God and neighbor as self. And these are not commandments that God asks us to fulfill in order to be blessed by God. It's rather the opposite. It's that God has loved us first, he has blessed us first, and so he's just asking that the love that we say yes to from him, that we allow it to transform us into people who love back. Typically, we as Catholics speak about the works of mercy. We have what are called the corporal works of mercy and the spiritual works of mercy. The corporal works of mercy: feed the hungry, give drink to the thirsty, clothe the naked, shelter the homeless, visit the sick, ransom or visit those in prison, and bury the dead. The spiritual works of mercy: instruct the ignorant, counsel the doubtful, correct wrongdoers or sinners, bear suffering patiently or wrongs patiently, freely forgive offenses, comfort the afflicted, and pray for the living and the dead. The two men who walked by the robber's victim, the priest and the Levite, did so because in their spiritual understanding of things, since they were going to Jerusalem to perform the rituals of the temple, if they touched a dead body, which they thought that man was, they would become unclean for the rituals. And so they had to make a decision as to whether they were going to cling to the good of their being able to participate in something very spiritual or help out in the needs of somebody who is dead, who according even to Jewish custom, they were supposed to provide for with the works of mercy of burial. And brothers and sisters, we can say that the same issues come to us, that when we are confronted with situations whereby we are asked to love and to act, it does mean at times a little bit of a sacrifice. Mothers and fathers, you know this, that when your children come to you at night and ask for a drink of water, waking you up, right? That this is a sacrifice. When you have to take time out, you know, in order to tend to the needs of somebody, this is a sacrifice. And yet, love loves to give for the sake of the other. And so, brothers and sisters, we ask the Lord to stir up in our hearts a greater awareness of the times that he may be tapping us on the shoulder to reach out to other people. And there's two things I want to mention in terms of ways that today, in today's day and age, we can lovingly show the goodness of God. In terms of the spiritual works of mercy, we can instruct those who are ignorant, but also admonish those who are wrong. And this is a very difficult thing, brothers and sisters, in today's day and age to do because of the sense that people get whenever they are confronted with anything that may contradict their understanding of their own freedom and their own liberty, that anybody who contradicts them is somehow either trying to control them, one, or full of hate, two. But we know that no parent who tells their kid, don't stick your finger in the light socket, you'll get electrocuted and you might die, is trying to control their child. They're just simply trying to keep the child safe. Yes, 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 okay. Good, I'm glad to hear that nobody is encouraging their children to stick their fingers in light sockets, good. But likewise, brothers and sisters, if we speak out today concerning moral issues as to what is right and wrong, we want to make sure that our heart is also in that same position, that it is a work of mercy and not a work of pride. Oftentimes people will think that if you're saying something, you must be holding yourself above others. And that's not necessarily always the case. Sometimes if we know the damage that certain things in today's society that are approved of, the damage that they do to people, when we know that, when it affects us because we've heard the stories of the people who have gone through these things, we have wept with those who weep, then we know that if we say, hey folks, this thing, I know you guys think it's right, but it's actually wrong. We do so from the heart of love, the heart of compassion, the same heart that Jesus had, the heart of the love of God the Father. Because if we begin to say these things instead out of a sense of pride, well, then we end up not so much judging the actions and warning people about their consequences, but then we end up condemning people, which is never what we're called to do. When we're called by the Lord not to judge, it's that we never condemn a person. We never make it personal about the person, because we know the judgment of Jesus for every single person is first mercy. It's first mercy. Jesus died for every single sinner, every single person who has ever existed and ever will come to exist, and whoever exists even now. So his first desire is that everybody receive his mercy, receive forgiveness, and be brought into the fullness of life that he has for us, for he is even better than the Good Samaritan. So, just like Jesus, though, we can judge actions and warn people about them. When Jesus was confronted by the scribes and Pharisees with a woman who was caught in adultery, and they brought her before him, and he said, "Woman, is anybody left to condemn you?" And she says, "No one." And he says, "Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more." He didn't condemn the person, but he didn't say, "That's okay, whatever you do is okay." He loved the person and showed the person their dignity and their worth. And so, brothers and sisters, we can carry this into action in the way we interact with people, especially on social media. If you're on social media, raise your hand. Yeah, the majority of us, right? And you know, if you write on social media, if you put a picture of a potato and you say, "This is a potato," there will be people who will argue with you over it, right? Yeah, you know. So when we get involved in these kinds of discussions, we want to keep some principles in mind. Number one, never attack a person. Never put down the person. Never call them a name. If you want to argue the points of a situation, keep it about the facts. If people come after you and begin to make it personal, don't make it personal. Turn it around and say, "You know, I realize that you may have some feelings about this, but it's not helpful for you to do this by coming after me. Let's talk about the issue." Because when we show respect and restraint, then others might begin to see, hey, this is somebody with whom I might be able to dialogue even if we're not on the same page. I know some people will mention to me, Father, we read your comments on the Dairy Chat, and I know that there are people on there who are men and women of goodwill, and they've mentioned to me in private, Father, we might disagree in some of these areas, but I always respect how you treat people when you are dealing with them, because you try to deal with the issue alone. You don't go after them. Another thing, brothers and sisters, that we can do, and it helps us in our witness as Catholics, is we can consider how the Lord may be calling us, especially to be family for those who don't have family. The works of mercy, again, corporal, sheltering the homeless. When we look at today's society, we know that there's been a breakdown in the family. And I know that there are many families in our parish who have volunteered to be foster family for kids who are in trouble. That is, not that they're in trouble, but that they are in situations that are trying for them and they need to be protected from dangerous situations. Safe, loving family is so needed today. A friend of mine and his wife, Alfonso and Debbie, they run a house in Galicia, Spain. And it's a house along the Camino de Santiago, the Way of St. James that some people are familiar with. They said that they welcome pilgrims into their home, into their albergue, as they say in Spanish. And there they try just to be a Christian presence. They're not trying to push faith on anybody, but they simply want to love the pilgrims. And they have them sit down for a meal. They have them talk about their experience. They have them share their hearts. And some of them say to them afterwards, Alfonso, Debbie, listen, I never sat down with my family for a meal. We never had a family meal. And they find community. If that's what one encounter can mean, how about if families are willing to take in foster children? I also know of some families who have adopted even children who were in foster care. So these things help us to recognize that if we truly love Jesus, which we do, then he's going to ask us in one way or another to put our money where our mouth is, so to speak. And he's going to challenge us to go beyond ourselves, just as there was the nudge that challenged the priest and the Levite, though they didn't answer that nudge. And so we ask the Lord for the grace that we need. The good news is this: if we lack the sense of faith that God will provide for us if we put ourselves out there, well, Jesus is the author and perfecter of our faith. And he told us that we can ask the Father for whatever we need. And if we're looking to do God's will, especially the acts of mercy, won't God also provide, so long as he is the one who's guiding us along the way? Certainly he will. Also, if we need courage and love in order to speak to people, patience in order to love people if we disagree with them, very simple. Those are fruits of the Holy Spirit, not fruits of ourselves alone. And so we ask God, who gives us himself today in this great outpouring of love in his body, blood, soul, and divinity in the Eucharist, the infinite love, the unconditional love of God poured out for every single one of us, as we say amen to the body of Christ when we receive communion today. Let us ask Jesus to also be able and willing to say yes, amen, to putting our love into action through the spiritual and corporal works of mercy. Amen.